ladies and gentlemen, decoding a 360-degree perspective of the consumer journey. And this session is partnered by Litmus 7, Retail Singularity Hub. And our panelists, ladies and gentlemen, Bhavin Kothari, who's already here, who's the VP IT Lifestyle Landmark Group. Welcome. Jackson Fernandez, Head of E-Commerce, PUMA India. Radhakrishnan, Gopalakrishnan, CTO, Litmus 7. Robinjith, Kalpaka, India Head, Retail Singularity. Siddharth Lulla, Consultant, IntelliCap and Director at Nita Lulla. And Suparna Mitra, CSNMO, Watches and Accessories, Titan Company. Welcome, ma'am. Vinay Chatlani, Executive Director, Soch. So now that we have our panel members, ladies and gentlemen, introducing the moderator to the session, Suresh, Madur, Executive Director, Retail and Consumer Technology Consulting Lead, PwC.
Good evening. Good evening, everybody. So we have an esteemed panel here from apparel, and then from an specialty retail, from Titan. So we have a topic today primarily talking about the customer 360 degree. What is the 360 degree of the customer journey, right? It's not new to us from the retailer's point of view. Okay, we used to collect the data in previous avatars, like collect the data from an POS system, do some kind of an massaging towards that, and do some kind of an personal promotions towards that. That's what we used to do from a customer experience point of view. That's what we used to do. And if you really look the customer 360, like in a view from a crystal ball point of view, you can see in and out of from a customer point, right? So nowadays the customers are coming from the multiple channels, like they are, like for example, like any customer nowadays, before they buy or do some decision, they do a lot of research. They come through online, they visit the physical stores or the hypermarkets before they really visit the brand store, right? This is the different the way of behaviors the customers which we see across, right? So having said that, how do we recognize them and how do we provide the best of an experience to our customers, right? So this is a discussion point which we wanted to hear out from a panel today. Let me start, like, so nowadays, like more often it is in a physical, like, so primarily if we see customers coming from online and then offline, how is it impacting the customer experience? As per you, if you guys can share your experiences from your business point of view, it will be helpful for the audience. You can start, please.
The point about uniform, consistent, and evocative customer experience. And the challenge involved in that was always there, even in the physical world. So, if I take the, in Titan, we have World of Titan stores, almost 500, and we struggle to ensure a consistent and uniform experience because it's very people dependent. Now, that complexity has been multiplied manifold because of the plethora of touch points, even in the digital world. So some of those are in your control, your own website, your own app or whatever. Some of them may be partially controlled, and some of them may be totally outside your control. So at any point, there is so much, you know, conversation going around your brand, and the brand can be presented in the manner that you want as a brand custodians. Or it may be in some other manner. And in that sense, the between the physical world and the digital world, the points of touching the consumer is so many. I mean, that's literally in thousands. So it has become a complex job just ensuring that it's similar. The second point is, while it is a bit of a challenge, it is also an opportunity because you can do lots of stuff online, and in a combined manner between online and the physical stores, which allows for much more of a 360 degree experience. And that is the opportunity, but it is hard to execute. And I think there are brands that do it well. There are brands that do it well at various points in time. But I think very few brands would do it well across, you know, over a long period of time.
Thank you. We have Vinay from Soch, which is a household brand. So we wanted to hear out from you, Vinay.
So I think following on from what was said, I think that's spot on. You do have to look at a 360 view at the of the consumer, because that's how the consumer interacts with you. That's how the consumer interacts with the world right now. So you, as much as you want to give a cohesive, kind of consistent experience for the brand, people do come to different touch points for different reasons. Facebook is a lot more informative. There's a lot of engagement. I think you go to Instagram, and if you engage with the brand on Instagram, it's more, what is the brand's personality? You go to physical stores for touch and feel. But more and more, you're looking at all these touch points trying to do everything. Instagram is getting transactional. E-com sales are trying to get try and buy as an option. It has to be completely integrated as a brand, because that's how the consumer wants it. So I think the question of whether you embrace 360, I mean, that's predicated on the notion that you have a choice. You don't really have a choice, because you run your business the way the consumer looks at your business, and not the other way around. So.
Thank you. Over to you, Bhavin, from lifestyle point of view.
Yeah, so as far as Landmark is concerned, this power of consumer database, I think had been envisaged almost a decade back. In fact, 10 years back, when I remember, there was an independent loyalty program, and organizers understood that there is a power in these data points. Okay, and Landmark came up with a whole Landmark group as under one umbrella, and tried to collect the data point of the furniture category to the grocery category to the apparel category, because there was that power had been already envisaged. So needless to say, today also, like, you know, this question itself is like now not becoming relevant, that is there a power in a 360 or a single view of customer kind of thing. It's a proven thing that there is a power. As far as even digital is concerned, today Landmark is the true omni-channel player, and our single view of customer or 360 view of customer, when you say, it's not only stopped to now that only one Landmark group physical store, it is beyond that, it is connected with our online channels also. It's connected with our social social channels also. And I must say that this is the power which is holding us today to stay relevant in the market, and in fact, in this kind of tougher market. And when I say beyond to this, this journey has to go further and further and further up only.
Thank you, Bhavin. What do you say that?
You know, so coming from a, you know, high fashion couture brand perspective, you know, we see today that the online and offline space are sort of merging. You know, in terms of from an experience standpoint, it's very important for us to create an experience which is uniform. You know, in terms of, let's say, average selling points online in India are not very high. You know, they're sub, you know, 1500 or 2000 levels. And for a brand like ours, where our average selling price is 40,000, and you know, customization is much higher, you'd probably assume that, you know, we really don't have much sales on the online platform. But however, you know, what we've seen is that for most of our customers, the digital media is actually their first touch point. And you know, Instagram is playing a very large role now. We're seeing a lot of inquiries coming in through Instagram. We see a lot of different interactions or, you know, customer views coming from the online store also. So what this necessitates us to do is that ensure that we've got proper teams ensuring that there's a seamless look and feel of our Instagram pages, of our online store formats, post that if people have certain inquiries, if they're not buying directly, even a back-end team who can communicate correctly and describe properly the kind of garments that are, you know, really there online. So what this has done today is that, we see that from a sale perspective, this really is, digital in the true sense that, the physical media has sort of, combined with the online media, where online becomes the first touch point. Customers come, look at the products. They expect your best and latest products online. They want proper description of the garments, the kind of description that a store manager can give. They want to be able to connect with you easily. And, post that, they'll make a decision and come to your store. So if our online media is not strong, doesn't provide the kind of experience in terms of, colors, in terms of, seamless ease of use, in terms of content, we do lose our customers to other brands. So this is something that, we're investing heavily in, and we are seeing that it's very important for, our brand at least.
Thank you, Siddharth. Jackson?
Yeah, so for us, traditionally we've been like an offline retailer. So we have close to 350 offline stores. Online for us has been a fairly recent phenomena, but that's been the channel that has grown the fastest, right? And as we kind of unravel the whole digital space, we see there's so much synergies in the online and the offline space, and both the channels bring in their strengths and weaknesses, and how we can bring in this a kind of connect between the offline and the online world. One of the examples you mentioned was about how do we leverage online content in the offline space, right? And we don't want to digitize offline just for the sake of it, but to find out where are the opportunities and how we can provide a better and a more a coherent consumer experience across online and offline. So, for example, the consumption of content. We're creating all this brilliant content in the online space, but at the store, there's so much churn that's happening that we are not able to provide that same kind of content in a consistent manner. So how do we provide this more digitally at the stores? How do we ensure that the checkout or the whole purchase funnel at the store is more optimized and it's a better consumer experience? So net for the consumer, it's a single brand, whether they are buying it online, offline, and today the consumer behavior it's not a straitjacketed funnel that discovery happens offline, purchase happens offline, and so forth. Here the inspiration can happen socially, they can do the product, the price comparison probably on a marketplace, they can come to the website, then they can go to the store nearby and buy. So it's very important that we kind of have our sensors in the right touch points where consumers are actually interacting with us, so that all the signals are captured. We'll leverage upon these signals to weave that consistent story, and we know exactly what consumer has done at what touch points, so that every time they interact, we know the context with which they are interacting with us, and hence provide the right meaningful approach at that point of time. That's the direction we want to move towards. Right? And for us, that's why online, offline, for the consumer, it has to be the same brand experience, whether it's online, offline. So whether when we think about content, we think about the strategy from an online, offline perspective. When we think about inventory, when we think about customer support, when we think about buying behavior, right? Of course, each of the channels will have their particular solves, but we need to think what are the connecting dots across these two platforms, because if the consumer happens to hop from one platform to the other, they still have the consistent experience, right?
Thanks, Jackson. If I can hear from Robinjith.
Sure. So I represent Retail Singularity. Some of these things that we are working on is futuristic. So talking about the consumer journey that we were talking about, the world, the current solutions that exist in the world now, say whether it is a marketplace or whether it is the brands, you know, all those systems or platforms try and get users' data and then try to connect the dots and then try to personalize, segment, and then, you know, try to give a good experience to the consumer. But what if, you know, some of this is more wholesome? You know, it's when I say if I am a consumer, I am looking at Puma or some other brand, Nike, or I might have my shopping experience across different retailers too. So if consumer owns that data, and you know, our interest is probably not to monetize it, so the retailers, brands should have complete access to it so that they can do their analytics, they can do better selling, better targeting at consumers. Every brand, I believe, you know, stand for a cause. So the consumers that has an affinity to a brand gets connected well, and how do the experience, you know, be? You know, even through different channels, say a consumer who is going to a store, he or she has already done the online, you know, browsing and stuff like that. He or she walks into the store with their consent. The store should be able to reach out to them and offer them what they were looking for with their consent. Okay. So how do we make it seamless? That is what we are working on. Yeah. Again, futuristic, but yeah.
Thanks, Robinjith. If I can hear from the tech side, from Radhakrishnan.
Hi, I represent Litmus 7, a retail, you know, digital design, you know, organization. And, you know, customer 360 is something which is, you know, very hot in the market right now. And basically, you know, I think we need to understand why everybody is today, you know, very obsessed about customer 360. Because we all would have heard about the typical, you know, the cliche, like, you know, being customer centric, right? So that's everybody. You go and talk to any retailer, brand, everything, everybody will say we are customer centric. But I think, you know, in reality, we can also see that, you know, how better, you know, how are we experiencing that as well, right? So moving away from that typical customer centric cliche to, you know, more of a measurable, you know, customer experience. That is what the whole objective of, you know, customer 360 is. And me and my organization are today involved in realizing that vision for quite a lot of retailers. Now, how do we do that, right? So this is not just only a, you know, what you call a tech or a, you know, technology problem, you know, that needs to be addressed to make this, you know, whole customer 360 vision happen. This has to be looked at it from multiple, you know, parameters. Like, for example, one, definitely technology is the centerpiece of it. But over and above that, the maturity within the organization, the, you know, that so the whole organization needs to have a mindset of that customer experience or customer centricity to make this 360 degree customer journey happen. So what that means is very simple, right? So for example, we have this all this tech stack, technology, everything there. We aggregate the data from across touch points, channels, everything. And let's say we finally, you know, somehow land it in front of the or, you know, respective business owners or the respective departments within the organization. How do they, you know, act on top of that? What is the level of collaboration involved in it, right? For example, you know, most of the time we have seen that there are issues within the organization itself, which, you know, makes, which actually becomes a problem in terms of delivering the right, you know, outcomes with all the data that we have, right? So ensuring that, you know, the people are also equipped and people are also aware of how to achieve that is something which is key part to this whole customer 360, you know. And then comes the next thing about the activation, right? So activation is the final thing where the end customer, you know, really experiences, you know, the experience that you are promising to deliver. And ensuring you have the right activation channels for your brand or, you know, your enterprise is something very important, right? Because today it is very, you know, awkward to say that I don't have a mobile experience that I can deliver. If you don't have a mobile experience, don't even ever think of that, you know, you are going to achieve really something great, right? So having the right experience is something also which matters a lot, because the future of you know, brands and retails are, or retail is going to be differentiated based on experience rather than anything else. And customer 360 is going to be the cornerstone of it. And we will talk a little bit more about how we are doing it for you know, some of the clients as we talk.
Thank you. It is a consistent message from all the panelists that the uniform experience needs to be provided to the customer, whichever the format they are coming in, right? That leads to another question to me. Nowadays in the market, to give a better customer experience, majority of the brands or the retailers come up with the loyalty programs, right? So from a loyalty program point of view, so what do typically customers look from a loyalty, right? There are different, each brand has its own loyalty program. There's too many loyalty programs. Like you download this app, there's something else. You have registered to my loyalty program, there is something else. So what are the retailers looking from a loyalty? Is it really return of investments which they're expecting out of a loyalty program? So what kind of a stickiness or experience which we are trying to provide from the different loyalty programs which we are providing to our customers? Probably if I hear out from Suparna, from the loyalty programs which you running for your customers, what are the what is the business which you are getting out of the loyalty programs, and what are the real experience which you are providing to our customers through that channel?
So we have a Titan. In Titan, we have a company-wide loyalty program that it's called Encircle. And at this point, it has almost 20 million customers on it. And customers come in from watches or eyewear or jewelry, and they can accumulate points, and then they can basically earn them and burn them. It is it's inevitable that in a situation like this, and all of it is within the company, that the products which are lower in price point, which is actually watches and then eyewear, get in the millions of customers. The points are always sitting in the higher price point categories. But what we do find is that it is... So there are two parts to it. One is, what is in it for the company? And more importantly, and secondly, it is the, what is in it for the consumer? If I see it from what is in it for the company, it is a very straight case.
Yes.
You have a very large pool of consumers. You can upsell, you can cross-sell, you can do lots of things, you can analyze the data, you can see connections of this kind of person, this demographics, this purchase behavior is likely to do something later. So you actually, once you identify the pattern, you can create... You can create the pattern so that more and more people go down that path. I think consumers have also become both bored and tired of the standard loyalty programs. I think today I was having a conversation with a very large bank, and they were talking about how they are, because the points that they get is not so much. So they have this green bank. So instead of the consumer choosing that I get one more product or part of the product that I can get from the loyalty points, I literally donate the loyalty points, and once there are 250 points, you plant a tree in my name. And that kind of, I suppose, alleviates the collective guilt on consumerism. That, you know, what are we doing to the planet? Do I really need, you know, one half of another T-shirt for 250 rupees, or am I willing to, it's not even 250 rupees, whatever. So there are, and that, this is really the point I'm trying to make it, which is the second point, which is the more important point, is what is in it for the consumer? And the moment you flip the switch, it is no longer a loyalty program. Firstly, loyalty, I mean, what should be that person be loyal? If it is loyalty, they should be coming without the points, no? If I'm loyal to a brand, I like the brand, I will come irrespective of whether I get. Clearly, it is not. I mean, I don't want to use words of, you're really tempting, you are goading, you are kind of accumulating points so that other people, you know, the consumers come in. So from the consumer's point of view, if I think about loyalty programs in general, yes, there is always a monetary aspect of the reward that you get. But I think this can be something far bigger than most brands and retailers are thinking or imagining. If you see how consumers have changed, consumers now want content, they want entertainment, they want games. We are still insisting that if you've bought one watch, you get one more watch. Maybe they're not interested in that. So the moment you open up to what consumers want in return for the business that they have given to you consistently over a period of time, it could be a lot more in the experience zone. And we know that millennials value those experiences much more. It can be a lot more, and again, this is a cliche, you know, we were talking, a lot more personalized, but not personalized from the sense of specific products, but personalized to a cohort. Like this green bank is a very typical thing, you know. I think there are a lot of consumers who would be willing to do that. It's got nothing to do with demographics. It's just that, do you have the mindset to say, I don't want another watch. Why don't you take that and plant 10 trees? Because it alleviates my consumer guilt. So I feel that firstly, the word loyalty itself is so much organization first. And if you see it from the consumer's angle first, maybe the term itself needs to change.
I hear you, it's changing. The consumers are thinking differently on the loyalty program. You want to share your experiences?
Yes, yeah, so we have a captive loyalty program. It's not alliance-based. And I think with Apparel especially, with a point structure, you can't buy loyalty. And I completely agree with that. And in a space where frequency of buy is a few times a year at best, I think, however, a point program can be a means to an end. So if you're able to track buying behavior, and you kind of have to offer the point system, because otherwise it's hard to get people to opt in with their mobile number or, you know, at least on every purchase. It's what you do with that data to understand the consumer better and make their further experience more personalized. I think something as impersonal as buying online with recommendation engines and things like that, even that's getting more personalized. So how do you use a point system to understand them better, and then you build loyalty by giving them more of what they want, which is understanding them. And I think that's how we need to kind of look at this.
Thanks, Ray. So my point towards loyalty was not primarily earn and burn on the points, like primarily from an experience point of view. The typical expectation from a customer is, like Amazon Prime, they get a better service. Being in a Prime member, I get a better service. Being in a loyal customer or the loyalty member of your brand, I get some kind of a better experience or better customizations, etc. Do you think the consumers are really looking at the loyalty in that particular manner, or it is in a real money, the earn and burn?
So I think customers want to feel special in some way. You do have people where the points matter, but I think for the most part, it's not the points. What is true loyalty? If you like the brand, if you like the product, you like the experience, you're more likely to come back. Loyal consumers are also evangelists, usually, and it's far cheaper to retain happy customers than it is to acquire new ones. So I think it's imperative for all brands to look at that and figure out how to make them happy. It doesn't have to be a point system. If you manage to understand them in some other way, personalization is going to the extent of even micro content on social and digital. So they kind of expect it. So you do have to add that to your repertoire of what you do as a brand.
Thank you. From Bhavin, you have a multiple brand formats. If you quickly can talk about what you are doing from a Landmark Group point of view, it'll be helpful for the audience.
Yeah, so from Landmark Group perspective, we have almost around 40 million size of the customer database. I'll not say it's a loyalty database now, as everyone is saying now, this earn burn is an outdated thing now. What customer wants is more of the instant gratification. What customer wants is the service at the store. Can I have a separate billing counter for me? Can I have served like, you know, free parking, wallet parking for me? Can I have the early preview for the sale or early preview of the latest offering? Can you inform me on time that, you know, what is the new collection in offering? What is the latest trend? What will suit me? So the whole loyalty as a program has actually undergone a complete change. Now it's more of the, it's a reverse thing, like organization wants to know the customer. It's not like I want a customer database for just earn, burn, and customer will be retained because I have a holding his points and he was one fine day will come and redeem the points and all. That's the past. So this now loyalty, everything what we have to look at here is in a clear context of the how can I serve that customer. And that can only happen when I know him end to end. Okay, what is his choice? What is his repeat kind of behavior, purchase pattern? What is his overall style statement when we talk from the fashion perspective? What is his...
So more often a personalization is
absolutely,
what you are looking
absolutely.
At.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. So just to support both the, my colleagues here, this loyalty as a program is actually an outdated as a program. It's only about service, okay? Know your customer, serve your customer, listen your customer, have a frictionless experience for them. He's going to online, he's adding something to his wish list. He wants to come and do a touch and feel in the store. How can you just connect this whole journey when customer comes to your store? Ma'am, sir, you like this product. I have that available in my store. Would you like to try it? Okay. So this is, loyalty is now not, no more like an unbound program. Loyalty is a purely now know your customer program. That's what I can talk about here.
Thanks, Bhavin. Siddharth?
You know, so just to add to, you know, what Bhavin mentioned, so, you know, from our perspective, you know, being a high fashion couture brand, you know, we don't run loyalty programs and loyalty programs don't work for us. And essentially, it's purely the customer experience that is, you know, really critical in terms of, you know, how's the customer understood, you know, if he understand his preferences, the kind of service that we offer. But what we have noticed and what we do a little extra is that, you know, given that the element of customization is, you know, very high in our kind of product line, we ensure that when it comes to, you know, even basic things like their measurements, you've got a system which kind of, you know, captures 25 of their measurements rather than just normal standardized, you know, measurements which are available on, you know, most platforms, which, you know, ensures that the next time the customer's coming through, they don't need to really, you know, take their measurements again. We have their data sizes. They can just check if it's, you know, proper for them. So, you know, customer service for us is the key. What works well for us is collaborations. You know, so we do end up collaborating with certain, you know, like-minded brands and other, you know, classes like, let's say, jewelry or, you know, let's say if it's a automobile company, if it has a launch and we invite some of our clients over there. So essentially, it's more of the collaborations and the experience and not really so much of, you know, any loyalty program that really works well for us, at least.
Thanks for that. Jackson?
Yeah, so for us, the challenges are very similar to what was mentioned. So for us, we have, it's a captive audience for loyalty. And in being in a category where people typically shop maybe two or three times for this kind of product, we've seen that the loyalty program has not really worked for us. And there were instances when we've thought that maybe we should like just scrap the whole thing down. Right? But I think what we are now doing is taking a very different approach, and some of the points that we already mentioned, we are trying to capture. So for us, loyalty is not just when somebody buys the product. There's so many different interactions that happen with the brand and with the whole customer 360 kind of approach that we are trying to roll out. We are able to measure some of these activities that consumers are doing and then equate it to whether that accounts for a behavior that should be positively accredited or not. And that's how we are going to define about loyalty. So people talking about us on social media, being a micro-influencer for our brand, visiting a store, etc. So those are signals for us that, okay, the consumer is highly engaged with the brand, right? Of course, there will be points or accreditation given to purchase also. But the way we then we incentivize the customers not just with points that you can burn, but with stuff like whenever there is a sale happening, they get the first shot at it. So most of the points that we mentioned, all these are in the roadmap. But it's primarily how we define that loyalty. That's the crux of things. And it definitely for us has not worked when we say that you buy, you earn, and then you burn. Because people buy probably a couple of times a year and they forget to burn. And it all gets wasted for the brand and for the consumer.
Thanks, Raksha. Yeah. If I can ask for the insights from Robinjith.
So like many said, the point system has become very commonplace, and you know the term loyalty, if it still stands, I'm not sure. But something that we are working on or we are interested in is the budget that is currently kept aside to give this consumer experience, customer experience, to make them stick or give them some long-term benefits, et cetera, whatever it is. How do you better utilize that budget in terms of this program? How that will help your overall sales in the long term? You know, it could be stickiness, could be many other features, like you said. You know, probably it's not just the loyalty, the points and stuff like that, but any add-on features or, you know, like the prime example that you mentioned. For the brands also, there are many such avenues that could be utilized. But we are interested in seeing how to measure that. You know, if I am utilizing that budget well, what is the value I got at the end of the year or end of 2 years or long term, right? How should I navigate this space to ensure that the budget is rightly utilized? That is something which we are looking at.
Thank you. So what do you rather?
I want to echo the same thing what Jackson was mentioning. So a couple of clients that we have been working with are definitely looking at the loyalty program as more than the earn and burn kind of a experience. They want to actually create a loyalty program where they want to create various tiers of customers based on the level of engagements they have. Like in terms of talking to them or talking about them or in terms of promoting them and things like that. And one of the other things that we have seen is that there is also a trend which is happening. This is basically from a financial perspective. If you look at organizations, they consider loyalty points as more like a liability on their books. So how do you make sure that you can quickly get rid of that, right? So giving more opportunities for the consumer to let's say burn the points beyond the place from where which they have earned the points, right? So that is another big trend, like whether in terms of allowing to redeem them for a movie ticket or a football match or things like that, right? So these are all some of the trends that we are seeing in terms of how the points can be leveraged for let's say what exactly the customer wants for, rather than forcing him to buy something from you itself for the points that has been accumulated.
Thank you. So this is my last question in the interest of the time. So if I put myself from a consumer point of view, so what are the consumers, Indian consumers, looking from an experience? So what are the experiences which they're looking from on a brand, okay? Are we ready towards that? The expectations are changing, the lot of millennial populations coming in. How do I provide, like we all spoke about the uniform customer experience has to be given to them, like from, if we look from a consumer point of view, what are their expectations? And how are we ready with that? And what are we doing for that, Suparna?
So some of the big meta trends that capture the customers' expectations now in retail and fashion in particular. One is that they want to experience everything right now. It cannot wait. And in fact, sometime back, somebody was telling me that even the typical London, Milan, Paris, fashion shows which would happen twice a year. If everything is available on Instagram the next day, how is that even relevant? So time has become very, very shortened. In fact, most of the fashion trends Of course, brands and fashion industry have a role to play, but there are a lot of fashion trends that get, that take birth the moment a very big influencer like Kylie Jenner puts something out, the next day it is a worldwide trend. It doesn't have to wait also. So there are those things that is, it. So it's basically very instant. There is no, there is complete impatience for any consumer saying you wait in XYZ months, I will come up with the trend. I think that that is just totally, that whole notion of waiting is totally demolished. And I think the second thing is also about premium. And when I'm saying premium, premiumization, it is not necessarily about very expensive products. It's at any level, the kind of value that consumers want is very heightened. So, you know, I give this example that you take a category like bed linen. There was a time when, you know, the best bed sheets would be, the ordinary ones would be 600, 700, and the best ones would be like 1,000 rupees. And then suddenly, you know, you see some brands coming up with 3, 4, 5,000, and suddenly your the benchmark itself changes on what is premium. It could be in, it happens even in FMCG. Of course, when times are hard, then people come back to the, come back a few notches, but in general, aspiration of every consumer in this country is always to have more and better. So that's another very big customer expectation that is very hard for brands and companies and retailers to fulfill. And the third thing is about this, what we talked about even earlier, which was about experience. So the product going beyond the physical product. The product is something that I buy to make myself, in the case of fashion, look good. And in the case of anything, feel good. And the feeling good should not evaporate the moment I've consumed it. The feeling good should be something that gives me a feeling of an aura of being special for a long time to come. And that is probably what brands are have to, you know, strive to give that feeling of specialness which lasts a fairly long time. But in general, I think customers' expectations are skyrocketing. It's hard for companies to match up to these rising expectations and not rise. And therefore, you know, all of that costs money, but not to be able to charge that premium as much. It is a decade of exploding expectations and yeah. Companies trying to keep abreast of that.
Thank you, Suparna. If I can ask Jackson, so what is an expectation from the your customer segment?
See, what I would say is it typically is it's very difficult to define that what's the expectation. It essentially depends upon the context in which they are interacting with us, right? Early on in their purchase cycle, it's probably they are looking for inspiration, at least in our category, right? And it depends, when we know the consumer is at that stage, how do we do a good job of inspiring them, telling them about the brand, right? at that context. When they are in our store or on the web store or any of the platforms where the product is available, the expectation is how quickly do they understand and how with what clarity do we communicate about the product. And at that point, with that problem statement, how do we solve it at that context? In the stores, how do I present my product, explain my product better? How do I use digital content? On the online side, what are the mediums in which I communicate? Because some of my products are very technical products, right? Like a running shoe, how do I use it? In what situations can it be used? I have a certain kind of pronation. Will this work for me or not, right? So maybe a chat engine at that point could help. So we need to think at the context of what the user is in the journey and then try to solve that. Some of it could be digital solve, some could be brute force solve, et cetera, and stuff. When they are through the purchase funnel, how quickly can I get them out through the purchase funnel, right? How do I enable them to use different payment methods, et cetera, and stuff? And finally, when they are at the support stage, right? What's the kind of support that I'm providing? So I think for this, the question, the way I would really solve it, to try to understand where the consumer is, and then do the apt solve for that instance.
So primarily you are telling you need to help him in the decision-making way or in the checkout point of view, the multiple touch points.
It comes back to the whole 360 approach that if I had my sensors in all the touch points that the customer is in, I would know exactly what point in the funnel they are, what has been the context from which they are coming, and where would they probably be going, right? And then tailor my solve for that. And the solves will keep changing because the context in which they are coming and going will also keep changing, right? It's not a straight line journey they are there. It's a very a haphazard kind of movement that they are making.
Got it, right? Got it. If I can ask Vinay, being into an ethnic wear business, like what are your customers' expectations from an experience point of view, Vinay?
So I think if we connect to loyalty real quick, if I put my consumer hat on, my loyalty to a brand is conditional. I want the right product, I want the right price, and price is connected to how aspirational the brand is. I'm spoiled for choice, I'm spoiled for convenience, I'm spoiled for variety. So if I'm choosing Soch over another brand, I still expect you to give me the best of everything. It doesn't matter if you're 1,000 square feet and not 40,000 square feet. They still want variety. They want to shop online and still get the kind of information on product that I would in a store. So I think it's being able to service that depending on the use case. That's probably what.
Thank you. Thank you for your inputs. Bhavin, if I can ask you, from your customer segment point of view, what is a typical expectation of the customer experience or customer 360?
It's like, the more you know, the more pain you have. I think we know all the Sahadeva story and all, okay? So today, actually, consumer is a confused consumer, if you ask me. I'll say why also. They do a lot of research. When they do a lot of research, they have a lot of data points. And then they have to analyze also so much thing. So what is happening here is when I agree what she told also, that everything is instant. But there are a lot of time is already get lapsed out in researching also. Okay, consumer goes to one side, one store, other store, is not able to make out a decision. That is the reality of today's consumer. So that is a parallel reality, I'll say it. Okay. So what can help here is how as a now retailer, you can assist your customer. How can you help them to take an informed decision?
Primarily, you are succumbing to the Jackson's point, like you help them in the decision making.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. So help them in the decision making with the help of technology, with the help of maybe being in the fashion industry, we have a lot of fashion assistant and all. Okay, so help them to take an informed decision at a right time. So when she says a right product, that is important that at right time we are available next to him. So today what is happening here is this, there is a silver line, how much we leave on the technology and how much we keep giving a human touch. Okay, and so that right balance is very much important here.
So balancing between the technology
absolutely,
and the human
absolutely.
Intervention.
Absolutely, absolutely. And if there is a, like, you know, if a retail, if a consumer likes a product finally, if he's taking a decision, then that is a very, very important factor that that product is available for him. Okay, and that's where the, again, the technology comes into picture that, okay, no problem, sir, you don't have this size, this color in my store, but it's available online. I'll ensure it will get delivered. So this all has to merge together, and that's what I feel that current consumer experience is all about.
Thanks. Thanks, yeah, Bhavin. If you can ask Siddharth.
I think most of the points are already covered. So I'll just quickly summarize. At least from our brand perspective, most of our sales really do happen, offline. Online is a facilitator which contributes to, around, 15 to 20%. So having said that, from an online perspective, the visual imagery, the amount of content, the quality of content is very critical. The ease of use, is very critical because even customers buying, garment which is high priced, they want to kind of be able to navigate through the website very well. They're looking for a lot of different content associated with the brand, which creates an awe factor. But the thing which is most crucial is that once they, go through the website or go through our digital platform, could be Instagram or the online store, when they connect with the store, it's very important that our offline team is able to communicate with them in the proper manner and is able to share the same exact information that we have online to create the entire complete loop for them.
Thank you. If I can ask Radhakrishnan, from a technology interventions point of view, to match the customer experience or customer expectations, how are you helping your brands or your customers on this?
So what we have seen, various brands today trying to do is that, trying to make sure, they provide the experience or the real, satisfy the real need of the customer at the moment in which, they are trying to engage. Like, for example, there are a lot of technologies today, like machine learning, artificial intelligence, moment scoring algorithms and all those things, which allows you to actually score that moment, what that engagement moment is, and then provide that exact thing what the customer wants rather than analyzing some previous or past data and then, throw up some recommendations and things like that. So that is one big trend.
It's kind of in a real-time.
Recommendations, that's one. Second one is all about, the pure personalization, right? Are you able to understand exactly what this customer wants and then, show that exactly to me. For example, today I go to, let's say, Amazon or somewhere and, try to browse something, buy something. Even if I bought it, after some time, I can see the same, the recommendations for the same thing coming. So which may not be what I wanted. I already purchased what I wanted, right? So understanding the customer is very important, and that is where, this whole concept of, 360, degree customer view
experience
becomes very important and, why that has to be a priority for, every brand and retailer.
Thank you. Do you have time to take any questions? Okay. Thank you very much, panel, and we are running out of time. The audience, the panel will be around. Any questions, you can get in touch directly, please. They'll be around. Thank you very much.